Hello and welcome to video 21 of the series. In the last episode, we had a look at the Hello World application for charts. So it looked like this. So we see here the just one of the examples from the chart library itself. And if you resize or we made this a paint window, you see this correctly draws. So that's nice. So what we want to do today is then get the actual values that we want to view. So this was just an example. So let's see how to do that. So this is what we ended up with. We have this drawing function, this rendering function, and this calls this chart content. And this is the example from the chart library. This, as you see here, yeah. So basically these are two plots, one a line plot and one a point plot, which are then put into one layout, and that's it. So and you see here the plot line values property is set with this lens operator to a list of values, and these are pairs of x and y values. So this is what the chart library needs, some kind of x and y value for certain types. And in our case, as we have timestamp and a value, this will be UTC time and the double, most probably. So what's for today is so that we can draw here certain values, and what we get is basically we're in the main window. There is a function. Where do we have it? We get a packet, and the packet itself. This is the packet. It has some properties, and then it has a vector of parameters. And what we want to display is certain parameter values, the ones we extracted in some videos ago. So a parameter itself has a name, a validity, and a value. Yeah. So we want to display only valid values. That's for sure. And the parameter name we will in the chart we will display only a certain number of parameters, and this will be the name will be the differentiating property, and the value itself. The validity, if the validity is okay, and also normally we will extend this with other things. So if the value will only be displayed if it's okay, or we could also do it that, for example, if the validity is not okay, then we could display red dots or something like that. I don't think we will do that, but for now, it is a possibility. So the main window gets a packet. We have to extract the parameters, convert this to a list, somehow store this internally, and then on drawing the chart, we should get these values and get the chart to draw with the values from the packet. And then we should see something. That's the plan. So let's see. First, let's go to the chart. So let's think about how to represent this. So the thing is, we have this drawing function here, which draws the chart. But this drawing function is actually called here as a callback. So GTK, when it somehow wants to draw the drawing area, calls this draw function, which calls our draw function to draw the chart. So this is when you resize the window, or if it gets hidden by something, then it has to be redrawn somehow. If it gets visible again, then it gets has to be drawn again. So this is when the draw function is called. What we also need is a function so that we can redraw the window when we request it. So for example, we insert new values, and then we want to trigger a redraw. Yeah. And in GTK, we can do this quite easily. It's just a little bit unusual. So let's add a function for redraw chart, which takes the chart widget. And this is just a monad. So let's say this is a monad IO. Redraw chart. And what exactly do we do? Well, we just call GTK widget QDraw and the drawing area, which is CW drawing area chart. So what you do with this is that you put in GTK's main loop, you put a request for redrawing the drawing area. And when GTK comes in its main loop to this, then it will call the draw callback, which will call our drawing function. That's how it works. The thing is, of course, we have to, as this is probably also called from another thread, we have to use this post GUI async function. And we have to put this into IO because this is all this is an IO function. So and now, okay, we don't have it, so we have to import the threading stuff. Let's see, yeah. Data G GTK threading. Save. And now it should compile. Right, so now we have the redraw function. So next. Data structure. How do we represent this? So we want to have a certain number of parameters per chart. It doesn't make too much sense to have a lot of them. So what we want to have is a kind of parameter for each parameter, a list of values or a data structure of values which we can easily append to. So my first thought about this is, and really just try it and use it, is to use a map from the parameter name to a sequence of values. Yeah. So let's just give this CW values. And we have to update this and multiple times. So this has to be some kind of mutable variable. So we just store this in the tbar. The tbar will contain a map from text to a sequence of we have these values which we want to draw in the chart. So it we could either store directly the parameter values, but then we have to convert them on every redraw operation of the chart. And I don't want to do that. I want to have them also already on the insert in the correct format so that the chart drawing itself doesn't have to do that much. Drawing a chart is quite an expensive operation, which we should care for. So especially if the chart is then interactive and you have to go to, if you move the mouse, you want to display the values of the points and so on. So yeah. So actually I want to have this in the final format, and let's do this with a UTC time and double as the value, so that we are okay. So we don't have UTC time imported, so import data time clock, right? And then we have the values here, so we don't have this set here, so let's initialize this. So we need a new tvar io and an empty map at the beginning, or no, we can also. So the thing is also what to put in here. So actually what we did in the last videos on extraction of the parameters, we did extract only two parameters, the double value parameters and not the integer ones and so on. So we have only these two parameters. So for this exercise, we will just hard code these values into the map and use that. In our case, for example, you have, for example, on the left side of the chart, you have a table where you can select the parameters and add them to the chart. Yeah. So this would then be a little bit more user-friendly. But for now, for the sake of simplicity, let's create a new data structure values, which is a map. Do we have imported map? Not yet. So, okay. Import qualified video map as M. So we just call from list. We create a list of. So if you create it from list, then it's an association list. So you have first the key and then the value. So the key is in this case, and I know the parameter values by hand. So it's S2KTP501. This name has special meanings. That's why I can remember them. And it has an empty sequence. So we haven't imported sequence, I think. Import data sequence as S. Let's see. Yep. And then the second parameter is then S2KTP502, right? And it's also, in the beginning we hit, we don't have values. And why I'm using a sequence, because a sequence is for appending at the beginning and at the end. So it's optimized for this. If you introduce with a normal list and you have a lot of values, then you have always, if you want to append something, you have to always go through the end of the list, append, go through the end of the list. So this is quite expensive. So I just want to use a sequence. It's a little bit unfortunate that the library here requires lists of values. It would have been cool if this would have been some kind of abstracted to a traversable or something like that. But anyway, yeah, we then have just to convert this to a list. And because of the lazy evaluation typo, because of the lazy evaluation, this should then hopefully be not multiple traversals. Yeah, so we have this from list. Right. So we create this, and then of course we have to set this. So the CW values. Oh my god, I cannot type today. Right. Okay, I couldn't make sure it's better to vector. Ah, and not values. Oh my god, yeah. Brain is slow again today. Need some tea. Okay, this compiles. Very good. So now we have some kind of possibility to store the values. So let's now see how we can render the values. So for now, let's comment this out. We want to have one chart. So these are the values from the example, which is just this amplitude modulated sine function. So let's just remove that. Let's make this a function plot and it gets some values. And then we set the values to, because this is a list of values, I set the values here and expect that the values are a list of the correct type. So actually, if we would make a type annotation, then this would be a list of pairs of UTC time double. And plot returns then something. Yeah. Okay. Of course, then we need to pass in. Actually, what should we pass in? So we will generate, as we have two parameters, we have two curves, right? So we will need two of these plots. So basically, if we pass in the whole map with these two parameters and then convert it to a list, and then convert the sequence to this list of UTC time table, and then pass it to this plot values. That should be the plan. So let's do it like this. So we give it a map of text to sequence of UTC time double, and generate a renderable. So we get in the value map. Okay. Of course, this will not compile because we pass here. We don't pass it anything. So actually, let's just quickly do that. So and this is the drawing function. So before we run the backend, so we get the drawing area, we get the width and the height of the drawing area, pass that in, and then we need to also pass in now the content, which would be just read tvar.io. From CW values from the GUI. And then we pass this to the chart content function. Right, better. Yeah, and one thing to mention here, we could also have done this, of course, with atomically read tvar. Yeah, this would be semantically the same. But interestingly, for some reason, I read an article where I said that the read tvar IO is much faster than if you do it in an atomically transaction, because it can use low-level primitives or something like that, and then it doesn't have to open a transaction and then close it again. So this is much faster. And this is a drawing function, drawing functions should be fast. So let's do it like this. So we passed it in. So first, let's consider the layout itself. No, let's do this later. So what we need is we have the map of the parameters to values, parameter values. Yeah. So we pass this to renderable layout is then the final output. So first, let's get the. So we take the value map, convert it first to a list. So if we have that, then we should have a list of text and then this seek blah, 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 blah. Yeah, this is then the value. And we should have, in the current case, as we have two parameters already in the map hard-coded, we have two of these elements. So, and then we can map this plot values around this. So let's map some other function. Yeah, actually, we can just map plot over this. But then we could, let's remove this. And then we get in a name and vals, so the values. And this is quite okay, because then we can put here the name, but probably one thing that I don't like about the child libraries is it uses strings everywhere. Yeah, and actually for something like that, you shouldn't use strings, you should use text. So we probably need to unpack this with the text. And yeah, this will not work. And tunpack, yes, we have to 63. Yeah, we have to add real text. All right. So let's remove that. And so we will use a line chart, of course, yeah. So and then we have to put in here the values. So the values are now actually we have to convert this vals which we have here, which is a sequence of UTC time to a list. So actually we have then S to list vals. S to list. Okay, yeah, this is the general to list function. Right. And okay, that's it for this one. So we have the name and the values. This should be okay. And then we have the layout. So we also don't have a name for this chart. So let's see. Let's just for now add a certain name. And then we have the plots. And actually we should pass in then the plots and make here a map to plot on the plots. And so to renderable and on the layout we pass in the plots. Right? Seems to compile. Very good. So the thing is, what we now have, what we should not forget, oh, the bindings for plot shadows. Yeah, I don't like shadowing. They can sometimes obscure things. And I have also this annoying scrolling up again. I'll just restart VS Code. Okay, we're back again. So this compiles. The thing is, what I want to have is what we have here is We have here set the plot line styles. The line color is set to opaque blue, and this is for all parameters in this plot. So I also want to have different colors for this. So let's see if we can do something. So let's this could be also be variable. So let's say we have something like chart colors. And let's make this a list of, so here we have opaque blue. So let's start with opaque, some other color. And I've tried a little bit around with the colors. And let's just go with green, opaque, orange, opaque, dark blue. You can add further ones. And also I want to cycle this. So if you cycle, the list will be repeated infinitely. And then we just, we don't do a map, but we do a zip width. And with the first list is the values, and the second list is then this chart colors. So we will get in not only this, but also a color. And we'll set the line color to this color. Okay, and then yeah, we have Rio zip width, and so this is Rio zip width, not S zip width, and then cycle is not there. Okay, this is probably let's just directly import data from data list cycle. And we're good. Okay. So team parameter values, we map them. So that's one thing. So if you ask what values you can enter here, basically every name from SVG standard, and for example, so here you have the names for the SVG colors. So you just pick one of the name, copy it there, and that should be it. Okay. And also, what I also want to do is change the line width a little bit. For me, this is a little bit too thin. I want to have them a little bit stronger. So plot lines style dot line width, and with the lens operator we set it to 2. Let's format this, save it. That works. Okay, very good. So we have set the color, the line width, the title. That's okay, and the layout. So this should be good. So we should be able to render values now. But we currently have no values, so it will not render anything. So how do we add these values? Well, we need some kind of function with how do we call this? Chart widget. Yeah. Chart widget add values. So we give it the type itself. And what we get is basically a TM packet, right? I think so. Yeah, we should get from the main window. So this will be called from the main window, and we will, or we can. Should we convert this first? Maybe better, because if we get a TM packet here, we have another dependency on the TM packet itself. So maybe it would be good to have just we just need the text, the name of the parameter, the UTC time of the value, and the value itself, which is in this case a double. And we'll make this a monad. It runs in the monad, not we make this a monad. Okay, chart widget and values. So we get the chart, we get the values. So basically we want to insert these values into the map. Yeah. And then afterwards do a redraw. So that's what we can already call. We can really call redraw chart. And here before we have to update the value. So in this case, we have to, this is a tvar, so we have to open a transaction. And actually what we can use is, let's have a look into tvar, so SDM. We have a modified tvar function. If I remember correctly, yeah. We have a modified tvar function, mutate the contents of the variable, and our modified tvar strict version, so probably it's better to use that. A tvar and then a function which takes the a, modifies it, returns an a, and then it is them. This is exactly, this looks good. So modify tvar, the tvar is the CW values from chart, and then we have a function, some kind of insert function, and yeah, that's it. And so have a look, this insert function, which should take this map and generate a new map. So this should be this insert. So we get the value map, and actually we need to pass this in also. So basically the type should be, we pass this in. So text UTC time double, and then we get the map from text to sec UTC time and double. And actually I don't want to type this out all the time, so let's just type value map. Let's just make it like that, and we have value map, and we return a new value map with the values inserted, with this list inserted. So we have to insert a list first. Let's first, so we get vals, and we get the val map, right? And let's let this undefined, and then we have, let's first think about just inserting a single one of these entries and not the whole list. So we will insert one entry and then fold over this map and insert everyone. So what do we do? Let's call this a single insert. We get it. If we fold over it, we will fold from the left. Let's just type it out. It doesn't matter. So fold from the left. This means the function single ins. And so if we fold from the left value will be the map. So in this case, this will be the val map and over the values, right? Okay. So then we have here the val map and a value. And the value itself is then a name, a timestamp, and the double value. Yeah, the parameter value. Let's call this parameter value PV. We don't want to insert all values, we just want to insert values which are already in the map. So the map contains this parameter name, and we only want to insert values for these parameters already in the map. So a value map, we could just do it like this, and also do it like this, right? And add values, right? So let's go to map. So this is map from the containers package. This is also exported from Rio, where we have it. Just a strict version, but basically the functions are the same from the name. It's just that the map is strict. And you have insert with key, but they are all generate new entries if you do something. And here we have adjust. Yeah. So adjust, you give it a key and the map and the function to modify the value if it is present. When the key is not member of the map, the original map is returned. And this is what we need. So actually we call adjust here. So it's m adjust. Then we need this function. Some function, and we call this on the key. And the key is a text. Yeah, so the key must be the name. And the value is then the the map. The name and the map, right? Yeah. It must be adjust. Yeah, the key and the map. Yeah. So the val map. Okay. And this function should then this delivers a sequence. And with this sequence, what we should do, we should append to the right. So this is the operator for the appending at the end of the sequence, the value. And we have a pair of UTC time and double, so T and PV. And actually we can, as this is a section operator, we can just shorten this. Okay, and we have this also in the chart, so let's do this with S. And catch, whoop. Ints is applied not few arguments, so of course what we have to pass in is the values from here. Actually, as we use this in the where clause, we don't actually need this. We can delete this and just use values here. And then we can just call ins, right? Haskell agrees with me. Okay, that's good. And then we have to redraw the chart. And that's what it does. Chart widget add values. Okay, then we have, of course, we have to export this. That we can call it from the outside. So now we can add values and then redraw. So there is a drawback to this. So for example, we use this for each packet. So we get the list of the parameters for each packet. But in each packet are always only two values which are interesting to us. And so for each two values, we get a redraw. And depending on the circumstances, this might or might not be what you want. Actually, I don't want to do this, but we let it for now. Yeah. So to keep it simple, but you would have to have some kind of a buffer where you can write to with a certain amount of a chunk. So for example, let's say 100 parameter values, and then also have a kind of a timeout. So either the buffer is filled up with 100 values, then you redraw the chart, or the timeout, could be 1 second or something like that, is reached, then you redraw the chart. So I haven't done this here, so but this is something to keep in mind for later things, especially if you have something like we have here, like an oscilloscope chart, which is real-time streaming data. Yeah, so okay, so we have to do things from the outside. So the chart should be finished. Let's get to the main window. So we add the TM packet. Here we added to the tweet view, so that we have this display in the table in the main window, and let's have now a look that we do add this to the chart, the values. So what we want is we will chart widget add values, then we need to call Yeah, we need to get the chart widget also from the window, from the data structure we have, from GUI, right? And then we need to pass in this list. So parameter name, time, stamp, value. So we need to convert this, because what we have here, we have the parameters itself is actually, if we get it out of the packet, so the TM packet is like here. So we want to get the parameters. So we have TMP params, TMP params, and the packet is called packet. So then we have a vector. So we need a list. So we convert this to a list. Then we need to extract the values which are valid. So let's do a filter on this list where we say that the param validity, so we have, this is now a list of params, and the parameter is a param name, a validity, and the param value. So we get out the validity. Ah, wrong one. And then we have to say if the the validity is valid. We don't, I think we have not, so we have the validity, where is it defined? Is it here? Yes. So we have no function to define this. So let's just add this. And the thing is, this is easy. So if it's okay, then we return true. And otherwise, this is false. We could even do this for the whole parameter. Anyway, so let's also export this function so that it is available. And now we should have, so we have a list of values now, a list of parameters which are valid. Okay, and now we have to somehow convert these values. Oh, let's call this valid values so that we don't get lost in tracking this. And then we need to convert these values. So also convert the converted values. What do we do here? Well, actually we get in a parameter P. And okay, so one of my cats did make a little bit of noises, so I had to care for her first. Okay, so converted values. Converted values, yes. So we get this P in, and we just want to get this triple text, parameter name, timestamp, and the value. So the param name of the parameter, then the timestamp. We currently don't have the timestamp because it's not part of the parameter value itself. And the param value of P. But, so we need to get then the timestamp and the param value, and we need the param value as a double. And I don't think we have, we have, so the parameter you see is a value. And the value is defined here. So this could be an int, a double octet string, and so on. So let's just define a function to double. Could also be a type class function, which takes a value and converts it into a double. And then a value int 8, x, of course, is a from integral. Right, then we have int 16, it's the same, and uint 32, it's also the same, and the float, oops, float, we just will probably need a real to frac from the double itself, so we can just return x. And the thing is, for the octet string, there is no sensible value we can return. And it makes no sense to display an octet string in a chart. So we could either use a maybe here, but then we will have to then also do some other conversions on the thing. So for now, the only sensible thing, I think, is if this then return a zero. So this is, this function is not a really critical value, and then we have probably a real to frac to convert this from a float to a double. Okay, then we have this to double, export this. Oops. Export this, go to the main window, and here we have to double. Right? Okay, and then we have also the timestamp. We need the timestamp. So let's have a look at the packet. Where do we get the timestamp? So we have here a times TMP timestamp, which is a maybe value. So this timestamp may be nothing. For the chart, we will need a timestamp anyway. So I think we will just, if it's nothing, then we will just get the current time. So timestamp will be case TMP timestamp packet off. If it is just T, then we return the T. And if it's nothing, get current time. Right? And we need to pass these values to the chart. So the converted values apply to the valid values. And, okay, yeah. Expected type parameter, effective type list parameter. Yes, this is a map. And then we don't have a two double. Let's see. We need. Okay, TM package has been added automatically, but we also need import TM definitions to get the value and the two double. Okay, and then we. Of course. So the thing is, we have an M, and this must be in an IO, so we have to lift IO. And. Looks good. Main window. TMP is redundant. We don't need a TMP packet. Well, that's good. Right. And the import of graphics rendering chart plot is redundant. Chart HS29. Okay. Oh, this has been added automatically by Haskell language. Yeah, and these are from the chart gchiro library. Don't care about that for now. Okay, so if now a packet will get added, the values should get added to the chart. And let's see if this really happens. So let's call stack run. Let's go here and fire up our telemetry. Import data sequence. We have forgotten containers in the carbal file. Oh my God. So we need to add this in the library. No, in the binary. Okay. let's see. Compiles, runs, and we have the values here in the packet view. We can display the parameter values. No, we can't. Did we make something wrong? No. It was just the logging is a little bit slow. So okay, yeah. So we have now everything in the user interface. And look, we have a chart. We have a beautiful chart. So you see, that's actually what is contained in the satellite data. So we have one curve, which is some kind of, it's not even a real sinus. It's more some sinusoidal signal and some kind of noise data. Yeah. And that's all we have here inside. So from 0 seconds, from 1942. 1942 0 seconds to 55 seconds, so it's about 1 minute of signal. Yeah, and we have a legend here. So we have this one parameter, this is the other parameter. We have the display here. This resizes. So if we draw this, whoa, looks good. So quite happy with that. A few things to mention. So actually, let's run it again to view it again. Let's dump it in. And yeah. Whoops. Okay, yeah. So because of the debug logging, it takes a little bit longer to process all through. So if we disable the logging or set it to warning level, then this will be much faster. Yeah. We can actually try, not now. Anyway, so the thing is, what now happens is, so a few things to make better. The one thing is this, that the redraw basically is better to do with blocks of values and not with single values like we do now. That's the one thing. The other thing is every value will be stuffed in here. So this is okay for this, as the file is limited, so you have a limited range of values. But if you want to have something like an oscilloscope, which is permanently on, then you have to scroll it out on the left side and get new data in on the right side. So we would have then, on inserting into the sequence, basically check for some timestamps. So for this oscilloscope, you would have then to define some kind of a time range, which would be valid. So for example, you get the now time and then minus some certain range, plus some certain range, and everything that's inside is okay, and the other things will be discarded, something like that. And then the display would happily scroll through. Yeah, that's the one thing. The other thing is this chart is not interactive at all, so there could be something. So if you scroll here something, then it displays the values. So a lot of things from which you can do now, also add other charts. For example, I will show you quickly. So just to give you an impression, this is RS. This is actually my try to write a mission control system. So actually we have here the statistics tab, which measures the performance. Is similar, very similar to what we have seen in the example. And here we see scrolling charts. Yeah, so these charts add up to a certain amount of points and then they start to scrolling. So we have the frame rate and the packet rate. And I have connected the spacecraft simulator Paragon CT to it. And now I will inject 10,000 packets. And then we should see some movement in this chart, at least on the packet. I don't inject on the frame level. So let's see. I start the TM simulation. It runs. And we get values. So this is the speed. This was a little bit short-lived. So let's make it a little bit larger. So we have the total time, the actual time and the total time as we have seen. So let's reset these values and try this again. Yeah, and now we're getting values for a longer time. Yeah, this is also a left-right chart. So on the left side, you have the packets per second, and on the right side, you have the bytes per second, so the data rate. And for some reason, they match up so well that you don't see the actually the actual value, I don't know why we don't see it now. It's too low here. You see it very, very roughly. Yeah. So it's too low for these things now. But anyway, so this would be a scrolling chart, interactive chart, how it is designed. You can use this as a starting point and do whatever you like with the charts. Also, of course, yeah, you can resize them. So this works also. And yeah, I think that's it for now for the video. Thanks a lot for watching.